we're going to be having, well, someone joining us all the way from Texas, talking about Ayotunde Onumbolo. He'll be joining us to actually preview what went down early hours of this morning, the game between the Golden State Warriors and the Portland Trail Blazers. It was all about the Warriors on the night because, as I mentioned earlier, two guys didn't show. But before we talk about that, let's get confirmation of the result of what went down in the NBA playoffs, Western Conference Final Game 1. The Warriors won 16 and the Blazers 94. Mm-hmm. So it was more like a 22-point game for the Warriors. They needed to step up. They understand that, look, KD is not here. And so Steph Curry had everything all right. 9 3-point.
It didn't look it didn't look like they missed it, you know.
Yeah.
It didn't look like they missed it. And you know, Steph Curry had said it before that, look, even before they beat the Rockets, we OKD this and we'll make sure we do this and ensure that you'll have a role to play in whatever happens in the NBA Finals. And some people have already said the occasion is bigger than the Trailblazers. I don't agree because for you to get to this level, there must be something about you. Well, you mentioned the name of some guys who appeared like didn't come to the party, Damian Lillard and CJ McCollum. You expect those two guys to shed the weight and do what is necessary. Mm-hmm. But it appeared that it looked easy for the Golden State Warriors, the Splash Brothers in full effect, and the accuracy of the three-pointers of Steph Curry. It's just amazing.
Okay, so I'm saying all of them? Yeah, getting some big numbers in there. Draymond Green also 10 rebounds on the night. Huge numbers mm-hmm. also for him. Steph Curry, of course, was the guy we picked as our top performance for the day. Before we go into all that, okay, there you have him. 36 points, and that's numbers of points. You have these two guys who were cold on the night, Damian Lillard and CJ McCollum, who had combined for about 54 points per game in the playoffs so far, you know, had this is the same numbers that they had, the two of them having 36 points also. Ayotunde will be joining us this morning, and it's good to have him right here, game one of the Western Conference Finals. We're talking about this particular game. Good morning. It's good to have you.
Thank you very much for having me, guys. It's a pleasure to be here.
Okay, your voice is, well, I understand you had to wake up. It's 3 a.m. over there, right?
Come on. No, okay. How does it sound now?
All right. Much better now. Good to have it. Now, what do you make of the Golden State Warriors? Like, they don't have KD. They don't have DeMarcus Cousins. So it's like, this is going to be a sweep. It's looking like it because CJ McCollum and the guys we expected to actually show up, they didn't show up at all.
Now, we must give a lot of credit to the Warriors, and that's because in the playoffs, the team has been built around Kevin Durant. And if you've watched them, especially in the first round series and then against the Los Angeles Clippers, the game plan was simple. Get the ball into Kevin Durant in the post and let him get to work. But once Kevin Durant got injured against the Warriors, they now had to go back to the original Warriors basketball, which we all fell in love with, where the ball kept moving and men kept moving. Ball and bodies kept moving. And that's what got them through the hump against the Houston Rockets. And that's what got them through in game one against the Portland Trail Blazers. It's always said that when the ball moves, when you share the ball, great things are bound to happen. And the contrary was the case for the Portland Trail Blazers, who had a lot of times the ball isolated with Damian Lillard. And the way the Warriors defended, and this is where I must give a lot of credit to Draymond Green, because I've always said when he defends at an elite level, it becomes contagious to the rest of the team, and they all play hard on defense. It starts with Draymond Green, continues with Klay Thompson, and everybody just seems to be locked in on defense. And exactly that was what they did against Damian Lillard and CJ McCollum. And it's interesting that Mo Harkless, who is not even a top three scorer for the side, ended up leading the Portland Trail Blazers in scoring. That's a great testament to how much of defense and the Golden State Warriors played on the Portland Trail Blazers. Another problem I saw from the Portland Trail Blazers was it looked as though they did not have a scouting report on Steph Curry and Klay Thompson. I felt on a number of times Steph Curry was way too wide open, even if it was from 30 feet out. You cannot leave that boy alone that wide open. You've got to do everything you can to fight through the terrible rugged screens the Warriors know how to set, but the Trailblazers did not do that, and they were made to pay so dearly for it. So Kevin Durant is out. Are they missing him? Yes, they are missing him, because there are times where, you know, there might be some very close games and you just need someone to close out the game. You need someone who can get the ball closer to the basket, who can work in the post, someone who's got a great eye for the passing, just in case he's double-teamed, which is what Kevin Durant brings. They also miss his defense, you know. But in all, you've got to give credit to Steph Curry and Klay Thompson. And he said about Steph Curry that the moment Kevin Durant joined, the last 3 years Kevin Durant joined the Warriors, those 3 years have sort of covered the greatness of Stephen Curry. Not like he can't play at the excellent level. We've seen him play over the last 2-3 games. It's just that they've had to rely more on Kevin Durant to be the generator of the offense. But now that he's out injured, everything has got to go through the man, Steph Curry. And the fact that he doesn't stay and stand waiting for the ball, he's always moving alongside Klay Thompson, it's going to make it very difficult for anybody to beat them.
Okay, it's going to be difficult. Just knowing that with the fast break that they've had so far this season, that they've averaged about 16.6. And for the Blazers, we've had about 10.6, ranked 5th, which is really 15th, which is really, really poor. Yemi got some questions for you right here. I mean, he's eager, be smiling. He just wants to ask some questions.
Tule, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
I appreciate you taking the time out. But look, I mean, we're beginning, it's just game one, and we're beginning to sound like it's all doom and gloom for the Portland Trail Blazers. I mean, to get to this level, there must be something about you.
Of course.
Was the margin that much that is making everybody dismiss them just after game one?
No, I think it's more about the effort they put in, number one, to the experience at this level. Don't forget, this is the first time the Portland Trail Blazers are getting this far since when? I mean, a lot of people watching the game were not born, you know. So, I mean, getting to the Western Conference Finals, it's not something we see too often. And you're comparing that to a bunch of guys who have been there. They've been the only team the world is talking about in the last 5 years, whether they win or not. I mean, they are right up there as favorites to win the title. So experience also matters. And then the fact that when it comes to the biggest stage, when the lights shine the brightest, who is able to become accountable and take responsibility for the team? We've not seen that too much on the part of the Trailblazers. And don't also forget that they played a grueling 7-game series against the Denver Nuggets. And if you've been to Denver, which I've been to, the climate there is ridiculous. Trust me. The first time I entered there, I had issues with my respiratory system. It was crazy. And now you have to go there 4 times before you beat the Nuggets, and then you're coming all the way south again to play against the Golden State Warriors. It always was going to be very difficult. But of course, like Yemi said, you cannot rule out the Trailblazers at this stage. For them to have come this far, then it means they've got some fight in them. I don't think they will be swept, to be very honest. But also, I don't think at the end of the day, they would have too much to be able to put the Warriors out of this one.
And the sweep there. Now, let's talk about today's match, man. It's going to be another big one. The Bucks and the Raptors, the Eastern Conference Finals.
Well, I mean, the Bucks coming off a near sweep of the Boston Celtics, especially considering the fact that they lost game one at home, and they absolutely took out the Celtics in the remaining 4 games they played in the series. And the Toronto Raptors, who had to endure a tough game 7 against the Philadelphia 76ers with Kawhi Leonard, making what, in my opinion, is the greatest buzzer beater we've ever seen in playoff basketball history. And the question everyone is asking now is, who is going to be guarding Giannis Antetokounmpo of the Milwaukee Bucks amongst Toronto Raptors? Some have suggested Marc Gasol. I say he is too slow. Some have said Pascal Siakam. I say, well, that's a better option. Yeah. But then, of course, you know, if you close up too much on Giannis, he's going to blow by you. If you give him a lot of space, something we've seen in this playoffs, which we did not see in the regular season, is that Giannis Antetokounmpo is making 3-pointers now with some good accuracy at that. And so it's the conundrum. That's the major question the Raptors have got to figure out. Because at the end of the day, even if you guard Giannis and you double-team him, they were second in the NBA in the regular season in number of three-pointers attempted and number of three-pointers made, only behind the Houston Rockets. They shoot the three-ball really, really well. That was on full display against the Celtics in the last round. So that's the question. And then I hope, for the sake of the fans, those of us who will be watching, that at some point we get to see Giannis and Kawhi, who are both small forwards, go head-to-head and see who's able to outduel the other one. It's going to be really intense.
I had to say before we let you go, I know people don't like to be put on the spot, but I have to do that to you. I want to you know, let you make a call. How far are we going to go? Are we going to see Game 7? You're doing a preview for us, and I like everything that you have said. I'm going to listen to it over again, so I see if it tallies with what eventually happens. But even before Game 1 is played, can you make a call?
I think Toronto versus Milwaukee, I think it's going to go 7 games. But I think the Milwaukee Bucks will edge this one just barely. Kawhi will be very dominant for the Raptors, but Giannis and the Bucks will ultimately make the NBA Finals in 7 games.
All right, Onobolu, want to thank you for your time. It's always, it was, you know, fun listening to you, and we've been enlightened. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hopefully,
thank
your
you
predictions
much.
Come true, then we'll give you some props on air. Thank you. Thank you very much.